Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us begin this morning in prayer. Let's pray. Almighty God, as we stand in awe of your goodness and mercy today, we invite you, O Lord, to be present amongst us by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we declare that we love you, and we thank you that you have made the way of love known through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray that you would reveal this great love to us all today as we gather in worship. Lead us by your Spirit to praise you, O Lord, and may our hearts overflow with thanksgiving and our mouths proclaim your everlasting greatness. It is in the wonderful name of Jesus we pray. Amen. A few housekeeping announcements. In your pew back pockets, you'll find that there are prayer concern cards. Let me invite you to, if you're in worship with us this morning, if you have a prayer concern card, if you have a prayer concern that you'd like to lift up in worship today, let me invite you to fill that out. You can place it in the offering plate as it comes by later in the service. If you're joining us on Zoom this morning for worship, let me invite you to go ahead and send that prayer concern to my email, which is pastor@mycumc.org. And if you do that before the passing of the peace, I'll be able to share your concern in worship. If that prayer concern needs to stay confidential, those of you who are emailing it in, be sure to mark confidential. And those of you who are filling out cards, let me invite you to hold that card until the end of the service. If you are a guest with us this morning, welcome. Let me invite you to fill out one of our guest cards. These are the ones with the blue rim around it. Located in your pew back pocket. You can place this in the offering plate as it comes by later in the service, or hand it to me in the receiving line following the service as well. At this time, I want to invite Tammy Detweiler, our liturgist for the month, to lead us in our call to worship. Tammy?
Please join me in the call to worship. Gracious God, you are to be praised for the women and men whose faithful witness to your love inspires each generation of your people.
Mindful of all those who have gone on ahead of us, teach us to follow their example.
To feed the poor, to support and comfort those who mourn.
To cherish and learn from the merciful, to be humbled by and stand with the peacemakers.
Let us clearly recognize what it means to be called the children of God.
And may we know that we are to be your saints.
At this time, I want to invite you to stand and join me for our first song of worship this morning, which is The Unclouded Day. Words are on the monitors. Let us stand and sing at this time.
Tell me of a king in his beauty.
Give the invitation to the table. Another little announcement for you. Over here in the bell choir area, we have our ofrenda. Did I do it right? Ofrenda. And so at any time during our prayer time today or our song of prayer, let me invite you you might have a saint that you've brought in your own lives to celebrate and placed on the ofrenda. But also there are candles there for you to light in memory and honor of those who have taught you the Christian faith and led you into a relationship with Christ. And so let me make sure that you know that that is an invitation to do so. You can do this during our prayer time today. You can do this during our song of prayer. You can do this during the communion time as well. We'll give you some space to do that. Hear now this invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Join me in our prayer of confession. O Lord our God, you know us better than we know ourselves. As we come before you now, believers and doubters alike, we all share a deep need. For we are all lost without your grace. Search us, O God, and know our hearts. Test us and know our troubled thoughts. Give us true repentance. Forgive us all our wrongs. Transform us by your Spirit to live for you each day, to learn to serve each other, and through the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord, to come at last to heaven. Amen.
Merciful Lord, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. At this time, let me invite you to stand up and greet each other in Christian love as we pass the peace this morning.
all generations, as we worship today, we offer our whole selves to you, all that we have and all that we are. Like the saints who have gone before us, we pray that you will help us to be bold in our mission and in our witness. May we, who have been given so much, give freely, ministering in your compassion to the multitudes near and far, so that one day we may stand amid the multitude that gathers at your heavenly throne. We pray this in the name of our Savior and Redeemer, Christ our Lord. Amen.
Who have gone before us.
God, we give thanks for our ancestors in the faith.
For all the saints who have been beloved to us.
God, we give thanks for our loved ones who have passed on.
For all the saints who have left us too soon.
God, we mourn their passing and they remain in our hearts.
For all the saints who have exemplified the faithful life.
God, may we learn from their ways and follow you.
On this day, we ponder all those who are in our hearts. For all the fellow saints, God, we give thanks to you.
On earth, in heaven, we are one. We are your children. May we forgive those for whom we did not have the opportunity to forgive. May we know that we are forgiven for our own sins. May we know that we are loved by the same God from this life into eternity. In the name of Jesus Christ, who lived, who died, and who lives eternally. Amen and amen.
A few prayer requests that I'd like to share with you this morning before Reverend Salazar leads us in our pastoral prayer. I want to remind you that to be in prayer for the Leopold family as they mourn Joellen's passing. We're going to be celebrating Joellen's life on this coming Friday morning at 10 a.m. So that's November 10th at 10 a.m. Here in our sanctuary. Be in prayer for Doug Cox. He's got stage 4 cancer, renal cell carcinoma, and he's fighting it. I got to spend some time with him on Thursday. He was in good spirits, but again, invites prayer. Be in prayer for Bobby Felty. Last night she went to the ER with some pain going on in the side, but she's now home on pain medications and resting. So be in prayer for Bobby. And then continue to be in prayer for Susan Ideas. She's still fighting the bronchitis, and I've kind of given her strict orders in the sense of stay home until you're better. So please be in prayer for Susan. I know that she's ready to get back to the office. So be in prayer for her for patience to get better and to get better as well. Reverend Salazar, would you lead us in our prayer?
And we have one joy in our family. Rachel's birthday is tomorrow.
Oh, there's one more. Sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Also pray for Keo, Sarah's boyfriend, hurt his knee, and so prayers until he's healed. Here we go.
Will you please bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, the great I am, you promised deliverance to your people. Here we are, Lord. Call to us in the midst of this world, in the darkness and in the joy. Bring us to your holy ground. Send your spirit to burn your flames deep inside our souls. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, hear our cries and the sufferings of your people. Help us, like Moses, to be the voice for those struggling with oppression. Flame of fire, all-consuming, remind us to be the light on the mountain, shining bright with hope and love for all to see. Through the cross of Jesus, you embrace humanity's suffering and pain. In the transforming power of your unending love, help us to set our minds on divine things, and to take up the cross and to follow you, that the world may know the hope of your glory. Listen as we pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let me invite you to remain seated for our song of prayer this morning, which is Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen. Words are on the monitors. Let us sit and sing at this time.
No.
Our scripture reading today comes from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15, Exodus chapter 4, verses 2 through 17, and 29 through 30. One day, Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led the flock far into the wilderness and came to Sinai, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of a bush. Moses stared in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flames, it didn't burn up. "This is amazing," Moses said to himself. "Why isn't that bush burning up? I must go see it." When the Lord saw Moses coming to take a closer look, God called to him from the middle of the bush, "Moses, Moses." "Here I am," Moses replied. "Do not come any closer," the Lord warned. "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." When Moses heard this, he covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord told him, "I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. It is a land flowing with milk and honey, the land where the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites now live. Look, the cry of the people of Israel has reached me, and I have seen how harshly the Egyptians abuse them. Now go, for I am sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people out of my people Israel out of Egypt." But Moses protested to God, "Who am I to appear before Pharaoh? Who am I to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt?" God answered, "I will be with you, and this is your sign that I am the one who has sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God at this very mountain." But Moses protested, "If I go to the people of Israel and tell them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' they will ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what should I tell them?" God replied to Moses, "I am who I am. Say this to the people of Israel, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Say this to the people of Israel, 'Yahweh, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my eternal name, my name to remember for all generations.'" Then the Lord asked him, "What is that in your hand?" "A shepherd's staff," Moses replied. "Throw it down on the ground," the Lord told him. So Moses threw down the staff and it turned into a snake. Moses jumped back. Then the Lord told him, "Reach out and grab its tail." So Moses reached out and grabbed it, and it turned back into a shepherd's staff in his hand. "Perform this sign," the Lord told him. "Then they will believe that the Lord, the God of their ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, really has appeared to you." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Now put your hand inside your cloak." So Moses put his hand inside his cloak, and when he took it out again, his hand was white as snow with a severe skin disease. "Now put your hand back into your cloak," the Lord said. So Moses put his hand back in, and when he took it out again, it was as healthy as the rest of his body. The Lord said to Moses, "If they do not believe you and are not convinced by the first miraculous sign, they will be convinced by the second sign. And if they don't believe you or listen to you even after these two signs, then take some water from the Nile River and pour it out on the dry ground. When you do, the water from the Nile will turn to blood on the ground." But Moses pleaded with the Lord, "O Lord, I'm not very good with words. I never have been, and I'm not now. Even though you have spoken to me, I get tongue-tied and my words get tangled." Then the Lord asked Moses, "Who makes a person's mouth? Who decides whether people speak or do not speak, hear or do not hear, see or do not see? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go. I will be with you as you speak, and I will instruct you in what to say." But Moses again pleaded, Lord, please send someone else. When the Lord became angry with Moses, all right, he said, what about your brother Aaron, the Levite? I know he speaks well, and look, he is on his way to meet you now. He will be delighted to see you. Talk to him and put the words in his mouth. I will be with both of you as you speak, and I will instruct you both in what to do. Aaron will be your spokesman to the people. He will be your mouthpiece, and you will stand in the place of God for him, telling him what to say. And take your shepherd's staff with you and use it to perform the miraculous signs I have shown you. Then Moses and Aaron returned to Egypt and called all the elders of Israel together. Aaron told them everything the Lord had told Moses, and Moses performed the miraculous signs as they watched. For the gift of Scripture, we give thanks.
Thanks be to God.
Before I open us our sermon time with prayer, I just want to say thank you to Tammy. I have a habit of new liturgists giving them like a lot to read. And so thank you for reading like what felt like 85% of the book of Exodus to us this morning. If you'd join me in prayer. Oh God, pour out your spirit upon us. Your word enlightens the eyes of our hearts. And Lord, empower us that we might live in hope. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It all started out like a normal day for Arunima Sinha. Arunima was 23 years old and was on the national team for volleyball and soccer for her country of India. Yet, on her train leaving Delhi, India, her life would be transformed. Her life was transformed when a group of robbers spotted a gold chain around her neck. The chain was a gift, and it held sentimental value to Arunima, and so she put up a fight. And she wasn't going to go down easy. She kicked and she punched the various robbers the best that she could, but she was eventually overpowered. And when they got what they wanted, they threw her from the train. In the next few seconds, her day went from bad to worse. As Arunima was tossed from the train, she landed on a set of adjacent tracks in front of an oncoming train. She was unable to get out of the way in time, and the coming train would run over one of her legs, and her mangled body would be tossed beside the rails. Arunima remembers the pain being so intense that she passed out. And she would lie there until the next morning when she was found. She was then taken to the hospital where the news went from worst to absolutely devastating. Her leg would require amputation from the knee down. But this is where the devastation comes in end. The hospital that she was taken to, they lacked the proper supplies, and they didn't have any anesthesia. Either the amputation would take place with no sedation whatsoever, or gangrene would set in, poisoning her whole body. With no other choice, Arunima instructed them to move forward, and they removed her leg while she was fully conscious. She would survive her trauma and be transported from that hospital to another hospital for recovery. Recalling this grueling process, Arunima remembered how the people would look at her differently. She remembers feeling their pity. She remembered the pessimistic ways in which the doctors spoke of her future. She even recalls her own thoughts of hopelessness, her own thoughts of doubt, her own sense of loss, a loss that was more than just a leg, but the life of an athlete. But one day something changed. As she read the morning newspaper, she happened across an article about some mountaineers climbing to the top of Mount Everest. And in that bleak moment, Arunima, she saw her future, a new future, a future that she would hold on to. She was going to climb Mount Everest. And over the next 4 months, she would heal. She'd be fitted with a prosthetic leg, and she'd have to learn how to walk again. And once she had mastered getting around on her new prosthetic leg, she started working on her goal to go and climb Mount Everest. You see, the stakes were high, and this would be a monumental challenge, but she committed. She committed to that hard training. She committed to conquering the obstacles that would seem almost unimaginable. And when people heard of her goal, people would laugh at her in the best of times. And in the worst of times, they would say that she had gone insane. Yet this young woman, she persisted. And she worked hard to build that future that only she could imagine. On April 12, 2011, Arunima lost her leg, becoming an amputee. And just over 2 years later, on May 21, 2013, Arunima Sina became the first female amputee to scale Mount Everest. Goal accomplished. But she didn't stop there. She persisted. Continuing to challenge herself, she would be the first female amputee to climb the seven highest peaks on each of the seven continents of our world, which she accomplished as she ascends the top of Mount Vinson, Antarctica, on January 4th, 2019. Now, ain't that an incredible story? It's absolutely incredible. It's a beautiful illustration of determination and willpower. But let's just stop here for a second. I want to point out one of the most significant moments in Arunima's journey. In her hospital bed, when all hope appeared to be lost, she made a commitment. She made a commitment to rebuild and reimagine her life. She would have to learn new skills, and she would have to complete a long, long training program. She'd have to combat her doubt. She'd have to combat the doubts of all of the others around her as well. And at any point in this process, it would have been easy for her to give up. But all because of this horrible event. She wrestled with doubt herself, not to mention all of the doubt that was cast upon her by all the many people around her. No one, not one individual, would have blamed her if she would have allowed this moment to dictate her life. No one would have blamed her if she wanted to just sit there in her doubt, to sit there consumed by her anger. But in her hospital bed, she faced her new life with courage, courage to rebuild and to work toward something new. And it's here where I think that we can learn something from Moses and something about doubt. Last week we talked about being lost in doubt, how doubt has this ability to detach us from everything that tells us who we are. Doubt can even create distance between us and the very relationships that form us. And today I want to talk about quite possibly the most pivotal moment in our journey with doubt. And it's that decision that we have to make whether or not we want to remain lost. Do we want to stay lost in doubt? You see, because there is a sad truth about being lost in doubt, some people just stay lost. They choose to stay in that place because to look outside their doubt, it's crippling. I wish I could say that most people move beyond their doubts, but some choose to stay lost. You see, there comes a moment after our first encounter with doubt where our worldview shifts. And in that moment, we find ourselves lost. In that moment, where we have a choice. Will we choose to rebuild? Will we choose to reimagine our lives? Will we choose to take a chance to develop a new vision, a new path for us, for ourselves? Or will we remain lost? You see, there's a choice. Whether or not we want to go on that journey. And no one is going to force it upon us. It is entirely up to us. You see, when Arunima, she laid in her hospital, she was faced with doubts. She was faced with uncertainty. She was faced with a future that doesn't look like anything she'd ever imagined, anything she ever wanted to envision. And sometimes we face moments in our lives that we never saw coming. In those moments, it is in these moments, it is very easy for us to let the crisis of doubt in the uncertainty to keep us stuck where we are. It is doubt that can be so traumatizing that it's a very easy choice to make the decision to not go any further. And while that is understandable, and while it makes sense to just stay lost, we can't underestimate the tragedy of this moment. Because for people who find themselves in this place, they will stay forever in the two minds. One mind feels the pain and the fear of moving forward, too apprehensive to process their new reality and claim ignorance and the past that doesn't exist anymore. And so there's this pivotal moment, a choice to stay lost or a choice to rebuild, a choice to reimagine our lives, the choice to allow fear and doubt to continue to cripple us. You see, Arunima, she found the courage to say, "I will rebuild a new life." And you see, we have to find the courage the courage to make that choice to rebuild our thinking, to rebuild our belief system, to rebuild our relationships, to rebuild our own identity. And none of this is easy. In fact, it could be one of the hardest things that we will ever do, but it's what carries us forward. It's how you and I, we continue on our journey. For Moses, this moment happens when he encounters God in the form of a burning bush. The tradition tells us that this happens at the ripe young age of 80 years old. Now, Moses hadn't had his first encounter with doubt and killed an Egyptian man who was beating a Hebrew slave, if we remember. Long after he had fled and ran away to Midian. You see, Moses hadn't been in Egypt for 40 years, and during this time he probably tried to bury that doubt deep within himself. The concern he once felt for his own people, Moses, he probably tried to block all of those memories from his mind. Blocking the thoughts that he had when he was in Egypt. Blocking out the suffering of the Israelites. But you see, God knew that peace that was deep within Moses. God knew that Moses was still lost. God knew that Moses was still conflicted. And God knew that Moses was not quite home. And so God encounters Moses in the form of a burning bush. God appears to Moses in the form of a burning bush and says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And I have seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. And yes, I am aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and to lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now go, for I am sending you to Pharaoh, and you must lead my people, Israel, out of Egypt. You see, in this moment, God looks past all the layers and all of the fluff. God is able to pinpoint and place God's finger right there on the very thing that had shifted and broke apart Moses' life in the first place. You see, God reaches deep into the soul of Moses and says this. This is the thing that has caused you to become lost. This is part of your story that has continued to plague and haunt and rattle you under the surface. And today I am giving you the opportunity to make it all whole again. Today I'm giving you the chance to face your doubts. Today I'm giving you the chance to reimagine who you are. And what did Moses do? Moses, he cowers and he squirms and he gives every reason as an excuse so he can avoid facing the whole thing that he's been running for his entire adult life. The Bible puts it a little nicer. It says that Moses protested. And Moses protests five times. The man doth protest too much, methinks. You see, Moses, he asks questions. Who am I to lead the people? How can I, because I don't even know your name? He says, what if they don't believe me? Send someone else. I'm not a good talker. And in the fifth one, he finally confesses to God, and it's what I like the most. He says to God, I really don't want to go. Send someone else. And I love what God says in response to all of these protests that Moses says. As Moses cowers and squirms and continues to be lost, in his doubt, God says, time again, I will be with you. You see, God gives Moses reassurance. God gives Moses encouragement. God even pushes Moses to confront his own doubt. You see, God doesn't force Moses to go to Egypt, because this is ultimately a choice that Moses and Moses alone will have to make. You see, God is giving Moses a choice to rebuild and reimagine his future, or to stay lost in doubt, to staying in two minds, herding some sheep there in Midian. And making that decision to stay, where it's comfortable in comparison to taking a risk and making a change. You know, I wonder if we know someone like this in our own lives. A person who has gone through the big moments of doubt, through those big moments of change. For them, even if their life is moved on, sometimes their doubts still remain unresolved. I wonder how many people we know fit into that character, into that place. Maybe that person is you. And like Moses, confronting that doubt, that unresolved piece of our lives, it can feel so overwhelming, and it is so understandable not to want to rebuild. It's understandable to be like Moses, to give every reason, to give every excuse not to deal with it. Arunima, it would have made total sense to just stay there in that hospital bed, to never dream about what life could be. But here's the thing about choosing to stay stuck. When we make the choice not to rebuild, despite our doubts, what we don't always realize is that we are actively giving something up. When we choose to stay frozen, to stay lost, we actually give something up. We are actively continuing to lose something. You see, doubt continues to rob us of our next chapter. And when we remain stuck and we remain giving up the life that we could have, the purpose, the blessings, the experience, and the meaning that exists further down the road, we give that all up. By not moving forward, we are continuing to allow doubt to rob us of those things. And here's where it fits into our faith. This is what that moment looks like on our faith journey. Sometimes faith communities and Christian circles, they try to turn belief into a fortress. They hand out a prescribed set of ideologies and mandate that their members built a fortress around a certain way of thinking. And by doing that, faith becomes this thing that is stationary and fixed in a place of fortress that is to be defended from the intruders and to be protected at all costs in life. And life itself becomes something to fight against, something that we have to protect our fortress from. But you see, there's a problem with believing this way. There's a problem with believing in that the problem in his life doesn't work this way. You see, life is forever moving forward. Life is forever moving Things happen in our lives that shift our way of thinking and shift our way of believing. Life changes us. Relationships change us. Events change us. And if our faith is to be built to be rigid and legalistic and unmoving, there will either be a day that fortress falls, or a day that we realize that we can no longer live with the fortress. And when that day comes, and when those fortress walls collapse, or we move out of that fortress, it could be tempting. It could be tempting for us to just sit there and mourn over the rubble, or to wander outside the fortress without any direction. And I'm willing to bet that we all know someone who, because of a moment in their life or an experience with religion, decides to just get up and walk away from faith and not believe because they're bad or simple or anything negative, but because the idea of rebuilding that fortress of faith, it feels daunting and scary. You see, I don't like to think about faith as a fortress. I like to think about faith as a road. Our faith, my friends, is a journey. Our faith is a journey that is meant to be traveled. It was never intended to be stationary. It was never intended to be something that was locked into place. You see, that faith is something that we take with us. It is the road that we build as we go through life. And as life happens, we continue to build with every step that we take. And sometimes it means that we change direction. Sometimes it means that we build on flat land. Sometimes it means that we're building over mountains. Sometimes it means that we're building through winding paths. Sometimes it means that our faith road needs to turn into a bridge. And sometimes it turns into steps that take us in and out of valleys. You see, our faith, when built this way, it is a road instead of a fortress. And in that, we find that faith is a lot easier for us to look back behind us, to look at where we've been. And we find it a lot easier to see God's grace when we look back in our own lives, where God has come close to redeem relationships. And we begin to understand that God is along that journey with us. Because when we understand that our faith is built to travel with us, but you see, we never get to that point if we don't make the choice to keep moving. To keep moving forward, to keep building, despite our doubt, we remain a prisoner. And that's why I think that's why God continues to pursue and push Moses. He pushes Moses to confront his doubts, because God wasn't content to just leave Moses where he was. God isn't content to leave us where we are. God knew that there were roads and experiences left for Moses to travel, and God was ready to travel there with Moses. And I think that's the type of God that we need. Sometimes we need a God who isn't afraid to push us, a God who isn't afraid to push us to face our doubts in those moments where we're just stuck. We need a God who's going to push us out of those moments where we're stuck. Imagine for a moment if God had responded to Moses as a protest, saying, "No problem, Moses. I'll just find someone else. You keep tending to your father-in-law's sheep here in the Sinai." You see, Moses would have missed out on the most important point of his life in the epic event for which his entire story up to that point had been preparing him for. He would have missed being used by God to deliver an entire nation of people from slavery to freedom. Moses would have missed shaping and informing these people to be God's own people. And Moses would have missed being able to see the promised land. And if it wasn't for God pushing Moses, we wouldn't be talking about Moses right now, would we? God didn't give up on Moses, and God doesn't give up on us. God continues to approach us even when the things we preferred, the things that we didn't want to encounter, the things that we didn't want to wrestle with, God will show up and God will nudge and push us. Because God knows that we are meant for so much more than being left stuck in our doubt and being placed in a place where we're stuck. You see, for Moses, he ultimately finds the courage to rebuild his faith road. Moses makes the decision to go into Egypt, and it says after the encounter with the burning bush in verse 29 that Moses and Aaron returned to Egypt, and he called all the elders of Israel together. Aaron told them everything that the Lord had told Moses, and Moses performed the miraculous signs as they watched. Verse 31, then the people of Israel were convicted that the Lord had sent Moses and Aaron, and when they heard that the Lord was concerned about them and they had seen their misery, they bowed down in worship. You see, Moses makes the decision to go, but I want you to notice what Scripture doesn't say. Scripture doesn't say that Moses magically forgot all of his doubts, does it? Scripture doesn't say that Moses was fully confident in his own abilities, does it? All the details in this is that Moses makes the choice to move forward. And that, my friends, is important for us to remember. Because making the decision to start again, to rebuild, to reimagine our lives, it can start even while we are still in doubt, and it can start even while we're still making the decision to rebuild our faith road, and it can start while we don't have all of the things figured out. All that we have to do is start moving forward. All we have to do is take that first step, and then another step, and then another after that. We don't have to have everything figured out. We don't have to have confidence in where we're going. All we have to do is to be willing to walk the road. And we have to be willing to trust that God and that our faith will continue to travel alongside us. Friends, I wish you all the best as you travel this road called faith. I wish you the blessing of courage to be able to take just one more step forward when you're feeling stuck in doubt. And I pray for you. The assurance that no matter where you are and what you're wrestling with, that the God of Moses will continue to show up and will continue to meet you and me and us where we are, to walk alongside us all the days of our lives. Amen. Join me in our song of response, Change My Heart, O God. Words are on the monitors. Let us stand and sing at this time.
Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Mold me and change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, God of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and martyrs, God of our mothers and fathers, God of our children to all generations.
And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery of sin and death and made with us a new covenant by water in the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, O God, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood.
Renew our communion with all your saints, especially those whom we name before you now. And as we share their names, let me invite you, if you know this individual, let me invite you to stand for them. Kurt Mueller. Min McKenna. Joel and Leopold. And for all of the friends and the family of this congregation that we have lost this past year. You may be seated. And since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. As you came in this morning, you should have received a communion, a little communion pack. And we're gonna receive communion this way this morning. And if you want to come up and kneel at the kneeler, if you want to go light a candle during this communion time, that is perfectly all right. And I want you to know that you need not be a member of Christ United Methodist Church. This table is open to all. And so you need not be a United Methodist. You need not be a member here. This table is open to all who love the Lord Christ with all their heart and who seek to be in that relationship. So at this time, I want to invite you to peel off that first little level of cellophane, exposing the wafer. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven given for you. Amen. The blood of Christ shed for you, the cup of salvation poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Amen.
Eternal God,
we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I want to invite you to stand for our final hymn this morning, which is God Be With You Till We Meet Again. Now, this is a song that since I've been here, we've sang this as our closing to communion probably 95% of the time. And part of the reason I do that is because when we think about this faith, and when I think about our faith, we're a part of a large tapestry. A tapestry that has been woven well before we were ever even thought of. And a tapestry that will continue to be woven well after we're gone. And so as we do that, as we come to the table of communion, we are reminded that we're not alone. And Halloween is kind of that marker in the life of the church. All Saints Day is that marker in the life of the church where we where the days are clearly getting shorter. This morning we had a time change. Tonight it'll be dark, like at probably 4:30 or something like that. And you will notice that the days get shorter from here through Christmas. And the whole point of All Saints Day is to show that those saints that have gone on before us, they continue to go on before us into the darkness of the year, to the darkest point of the year when the Christ child is born and light is brought back anew. And so this morning, as we close in this hymn together, I want you to remember all of those individuals who have led you and loved you into the faith. To remember all the sacrifices, all the love, all the joy, all the laughter that they gave to you. And to remember that they wait for this heavenly banquet as well. And that they cheer us on every step of the way. And they encourage us, you and I, to do the work of a disciple here and now. To make others who have yet to be woven into this tapestry, to make a place for them to show that same love, that same support, that same encouragement to them. So at this time, let me invite you to stand and sing, God Be With You, till we meet again. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 3, right? 1, 2, and 3. Stand and sing at this time. Your bulletin is full of announcements. I want to remind you that Tuesday is food pantry. If you haven't helped with that, let me invite you to do so. It's a great time to be in service in community with our neighbors and to serve them food. And so let me invite you to consider doing that. We're going to be, that starts Tuesday morning. Get here about 10 o'clock. That's probably about good. If you have any other questions, you can talk to Linda Kaiser, who's in the nursery. Or catch me after the service. And I want you to also remember that pie making is Thursday morning at 9 a.m., and if you ordered a pie, you'll be able to pick it up after church next Sunday. Again, there are plenty of other announcements in your bulletin. Remember that we're going to be celebrating Joelle and Leopold's life this coming Friday at 10 a.m., so please keep that in mind. Sure.
I just want to say thank you to everybody who donated candy or helped last Sunday with Trunk or Treat. Those of you who came out and braved the cold and the wind. I think given the weather, we had a really good turnout from the community, and I really appreciate, especially Michelle and Danielle. And I just want to say thanks.
Thank you. Yep. Again, there are more announcements in your bulletin. Take time to read that. Susan doesn't just type them in there for no reason, so be sure to read your bulletin. Huh? Oh, and Sarah's got a food box. Go up and tell them about it.
Hi. So for Eastern New Mexico, Roswell, we're doing a food drive for the food pantry on campus. So I'm going to be bringing a box, and if you want to leave some canned goods and hygiene products in there, that would be awesome and greatly appreciated. Thank you.
Remember, these are that food drive is for college students, and NMU Roswell, kind of where it's located, is more or less a food desert, not really any grocery store anywhere near that campus. So I'm going to go and do my best to love people like Jesus, and I hope you'll do the same.
Amen.